right. Hello, everybody, and welcome to Fireside Chat number 70, Arrested in Scotland. I'm your host, Brian Martinez, and what you were just listening to was Promontory. It's the main theme from Last of the Mohicans. It was just a song that I wanted to hear. So we tried to play some music before the show starts just to make sure that nothing gets cut off in the beginning. So I am joined here by Dr. Ranabrakam as well as Goodfella. And Count Dankula will be joining us a little bit later. Hey, Goodfella, how are you doing?
I'm good, thanks. So can I just say, Brian? See when Skeptor sent me a message to let me know that you wanted me on here, right? Mm-hmm. When he brought you into the chat, he said, "Right now, kiss and make up." And I was thinking, did we fall out? And I don't know about it.
No, I don't know. I don't think that happened at all. I actually adore you quite a bit, good fellow.
He just wanted you to wear makeup.
Did that fall out with the honey badgers or something? And I don't remember.
No.
Jesus.
No, nothing like that. Unless that's one of Skeptor's Jewish tricks to just try to look. No, more.
I right enough. I didn't think of that. He's always got them up his sleeve.
Well, welcome
and
to the show.
In his bag around his neck.
That's right. And so I also have Mike here, and hopefully Count Dankula will be joining us a little bit later on. He did say he could come on. I wanted to essentially get the story on what happened with you, Goodfella. Tell us the story about what happened. I know that you've talked about this on your channel, and you've talked mm-hmm. about it at length, but this is for anybody who may not know. So yeah, tell us the story.
Just to quickly sum up, I was arrested by the police for a tweet that was on my account. Someone posted a tweet on my account, wink wink, and I don't know who it was, but anyway, this tweet had said, "Where's a Muslim with a truck when you need one? Hashtag Pride Glasgow," which is the gay pride parade, you know. And of course the police and the guy who made the complaint was the director of Pride Glasgow. Mm-hmm. Just to let you know, he actually literally went to the police station. He didn't phone them. He actually went to the police station. That's how much energy he used to make this complaint. Him and the Glasgow police said that a Muslim with a truck means terrorist. I don't know why they think that. Sounds a bit bigoted to me. It seems like it to me. And they also said that the tweet is suggesting that gay people deserve to die. So I was put in jail for the weekend. I got out on the Monday, went to court, the sheriff's court, and the procurator fiscal dismissed it. It was a PF pass, it's called, and it means that they don't have the means or the time to deal with it right now. There's more important things. And now I'm just playing the waiting game. I've just to wait to hear from them. So if I get a letter through the door saying, right, you have to go to court, then I'll have a court date. If not, then it might just, you know, disappear, you know. But mm-hmm. I still don't know right now what's happening next, either something or nothing, but I don't know. Nobody's really telling me anything.
So I got a couple of questions about this. One, mm-hmm. did the police actually show up at your door to take you
yes.
away? And did you,
yes, I have,
what were your thoughts when you saw them at the door? Like, what were you thinking?
Well, I mean, it's what, when you see the police right away, you think something bad's happened to somebody you know, right? And maybe in your family, right? Especially because I'm a law-abiding citizen. I don't have the police at my door all the mm-hmm. time, you know? So to see them at the door right away, I thought something's happened. But then when I seen the look on their faces, I could tell that it was nothing really serious, if that makes sense. I could just tell that, you know, there was nothing serious. And they said, "Oh, do you mind if we come in to have a word?" And, you know, sure, no problem. And then, but I mean, luckily, right, I have it on video, right? I have them detaining me and telling me all this on video, because when I answer the door, when I'm not expecting somebody, I always put my 360 camera on. It's like a 360 degree camera. Mm-hmm. And I put that on and I just leave that sitting just near the door. So that it's for my own protection more than anything, you know, so that if anybody comes to the door and, maybe then accuses me of hitting them or something like that. I've got evidence that I didn't. You know, it's just something I do all the time. Sure. So I've actually got the video of them coming into my house and detaining me, and they seen the camera. You know, they actually pointed to the camera and they seen it. So I have that, but other than that, I don't really have anything. You know, like I didn't get anything from the court to say, here, by the way, this is what happened. I don't really have anything. But when they came to my door, it was a shock at first, but that was only for like 2 seconds, and then I realized this isn't that serious because I could tell with the look on their face.
Like the police themselves weren't really, like they felt like they were wasting their time too, or?
Well, I got the impression, especially from the woman, it was a man and a woman, but I got the impression from her that she was like, almost without saying anything, her face was almost apologetic, like I'm sorry, I don't want to be doing this, you know, mm-hmm. I didn't sign up for this, but I have to do it, it's just my job. That's the feeling I got from her, you know, a bit from him as well. But when I compare it with what Count Dankula went through, it is the police were quite horrible with him, you know, and desperate to arrest him and stuff, and quite rude and stuff. Mm-hmm. But the police that came to my door, they weren't rude to me or anything like that. They weren't disrespectful or anything. They were actually quite pleasant, you know. So I, again, behavior breeds behavior. So I was just being pleasant back, you know.
Sure.
I had no reason to be antagonistic or anything like that. But again, at this point, I hadn't, in my view, I hadn't done anything wrong. And then when they said to me, we have to detain you about something you posted on social media, something about a communications act or something like that, I just laughed because I thought, this is like surreal. This is bizarre. I can't. Are you really here to talk to me about something that was posted on social media? Now, I know that I tell a lot of jokes, and you know, being Scottish, our humour is quite, you know, to the bone. You know, it can be quite cutting sometimes.
Sure.
But I'm not a hateful person. You know, I'm more of a mocking person. I mock people and that I dislike. So it was a bit of a shock, it was funny at the same time and bizarre, and you know, it's very, very strange.
Quite an
experience. Situation to be in.
Yeah. So this social media tweet about the ice cream truck that people were hoping for to sell ice cream to the gay people. I mean, they had those rainbow cones, you know. I mean, it would have been perfect, mm-hmm. if they would have just let them. And you know, gay people like kebabs too. So, but
exactly.
Yeah, because they're good. But no,
and it's funny, this guy from Pride Glasgow saw one tweet on sent on your account somehow about
yes.
a kebab fan, and his response is to go directly to the police station to report a crime. Whereas,
that's right. I mean,
whereas Jess Phillips gets hundreds of rape threats on Twitter, right? Definitely credible rape threats that are definitely rape threats, and her response is to complain about it on Twitter.
Yeah,
I can't tell where anyone's priorities are anymore.
We do have a Count Dankula here. Hello, Count. How are you?
Oh, Count.
Hello, everyone. Hi, how's it going?
Good. How are you, sir?
I'm all right, man. Also, good fella. Welcome at the club, man. Welcome. It's a very... The club's becoming less and less exclusive as time goes on. Soon, everybody's going to be fucking in it.
That's the thing. Yeah, everybody in the chat, everybody watching this, you could be next. That's how ridiculous this is. You could be next. I was just talking about you, Count, there for a second. I was saying the police that arrested me were actually quite pleasant, but it's different for you, isn't it? They were bastards, basically. Am I right?
Well, one was pleasant, one wasn't. One was actually really nice to me. It was the woman in the picture that you see. She was actually really nice to me and everything like that. But the guy was the one that was saying stuff to me in the police station, saying that I was actually trying to normalise Nazism and I was actually a Nazi and that my video could actually inspire people to hate Jews and stuff like that. Yeah, just fucking absolute fucking stupidity like that. The only problem is when he said it to me, I started laughing. it's the best idea.
It's hilarious. I mean, can you imagine being the guy who's like, I really want to be a Nazi, but what I need is to see a pug with his paw up in the air, and that will be the thing that's gonna make me go full gas chamber. Only until I see that, though. It's
yeah, it's not good. It's not going to be things like the biased hate crime laws or the, you know, diversity quotas or the fact that people can actually legally walk through the street screaming "fuck white people" and stuff like that. It's going to be a video of a dog lifting its paw. That's going to be the push that sends society over into the far right. That's what's going to start it.
Yeah,
yeah, it's fucking ridiculous, man.
Mitch, in the chat, gives us £2, and he says, "Give Mitch his memes back." So I don't know what that means, but I'm just reading it because he gave us some super chat. Someone else said something. Toothless420 says, "Making joke about Nazis equals support Nazis. Making joke about Jews, anti-Semitism." Absolutely. All right, I'm gonna give you guys the floor back. So, well, let me ask you this: is it illegal for people to post this stuff on social media in Scotland? Like, what law was broken specifically? I'm curious.
It would have been probably the same one as me. Was it the Offensive Communications Act with the hate crime tag added on there? Yeah,
that was the one. Something communications. I think that was the Communications Act. You know, and they're clamping down on this online hate. You know, by taking tweets out of context and stuff. They're really clamping down. You know, glad they're doing their job because I feel safer.
I didn't know you could hurt Scott's feelings. I thought that was. It seems.
Yeah, well, yeah, that's the thing. You can't, but it's the victim group thing, because when I was getting questioned, they said to me, you know, that this is offensive in a religious and sexual nature. You know, and I mean, I'm laughing, but at the same time, I'm just going, no comment, no comment. Did you no comment as well, Count? Did you no comment all the way through your interview, or did you talk to them?
No, I did this thing where, like, see anything they accused me of, I would ask a question back and go, well, can you explain how that is? And they couldn't. Mm-hmm. So I says, well, no, if you don't even know what you mean, how am I supposed to know what you mean? And everyone as well, it was obviously they were trying to get me to slip up and say certain things, but I was just asking questions back, and see, because they couldn't answer my questions, I was like, oh, am I falling away for the little model that you've built? Am I not saying the right things here? And they sort of started to fumble and everything. So that's when I just went out. And I did get to a point where I says, yous aren't listening. I'm not saying anything until I speak to a lawyer and all that. But I didn't say anything. No.
The funny thing about it, with your video and maybe to a certain extent, that tweet that was posted on my account. The funny thing about it is I would never have seen that video if you didn't get arrested.
I do actually need to thank Daily Record and the Scottish Sun and all that for giving my channel growth. I do actually owe them some thanks for that. But it was the fact is as well, they were saying, oh, look at this video, it's absolutely offensive. So what we're going to do is use our media platform to show it to everyone. Like, the video itself is actually still hosted on the Daily Record's website. It's not even a link to, like, my original YouTube video. It's actually hosted on their site. And everyone, so, like, that was the whole thing I'm charged under was posting an offensive communication. Well, they've done that exact same thing themselves.
Uh-huh. Yeah, they're spreading it more.
Like,
aren't
so
they?
I don't. I
think one of,
yeah, exactly. So
one of the big differences between mine and Dankula's situation is that his is a video. And he's in the video, so he can't say, well, it wasn't me. You know, whereas I don't know who wrote that tweet on my computer. I've no idea. This house is very busy, you know. So that there's a difference there as well. That's how I think. I don't think any of them's worse, because both of us should never have had a visit from the police to start with. I mean, it's ridiculous.
No, it's ridiculous.
I think, see, unless you actually send a direct threat, actually encouraging violence, so you say, like, mm-hmm. I'm going to come down to your house and I'm going to kick the shit out of you, then, yeah, right. I would understand the police getting involved in that. But see, even with my video, I gave more than enough context for everybody to know what I meant.
Exactly, aye.
They didn't actually give a shit. So context doesn't even matter. If you say anything along those lines, then...
Yeah,
it's got to the point where, in fact, those headlines I've seen where apparently To Kill a Mockingbird is actually going to get completely removed from the US mm-hmm. curriculum because it contains the word nigger.
Yep.
And it's like, I'm sorry, but it's in the context of it, it's a book that was written during a very racist time and it's portraying a sort of kind of racist era. So you're going to hear that word more than twice. Like, that's even been completely removed because apparently the context doesn't matter.
No, the whole point, they do the same thing with Huckleberry Finn.
But the whole point of that book, To Kill a Mockingbird, the whole point is to make you feel uncomfortable. That's the point of the book. So if the word makes you feel uncomfortable, good. That's what you're supposed to feel. Yeah. You're not supposed to, it's not a happy story. It's not the fucking Wizard of Oz. It's supposed to be like that.
So the determined lad gave us £5, and he asks, he says, ask why Scotland is considerably more left-wing than England. I'm also half Scottish myself, and all my Scottish friends are Marxist sympathizers. I don't have the answer to this. I don't even know if it's true.
I think it's because of there's a lot of hatred for the Tories here. The Tories are the Conservative Party, right wing, right? And there's a lot of hatred here, and it's been going on for years. And we're basically raised to hate the Tories. I don't like that, by the way. I hate that. I hate that whole thing. But that's the way we're raised here. We're raised to hate the Tories, and it kind of works. It's horrible, but it works. And I think that's why a lot of people...
I think you're right, though. It's kind of like, what is the opposite of Tories or the far left? Well, we're going to believe in that then. Like, I think that literally is it.
Yeah, ironically, there's also quite a sort of nationalist sensibility because they also hate the English. Not all of them, obviously. But there is, to some degree, it's a sort of a myth and a stereotype, but a lot of Scottish people really do hate the English.
Some of them, it's just a meme. The hating English thing is sort of just a meme where it's like, we say it jokingly and stuff, but there are some hardcore groups that actually flat out hate the English.
Because we've been right next door to each other for centuries, just as the same sort of countries, and sort of England's been romping around the world building an empire, and Scotland's been kind of, which sort of proves The English Empire wasn't particularly bastardy, because we took over fucking India, we took over huge swathes of Africa, and we just left Scotland there, right next to us. Never bothered invading it. I mean, after Hadrian or whatever.
you guys
can have your
times. There's been a few times, but I think that right now it's like a football banter. There's a good back and forth, but you're always going to get those hateful ones, you know. And I've noticed it. I've noticed it, especially with football. If Scotland are playing like a big team, England, English people want Scotland to win, whereas the other way around, Scottish people don't want England to win. And it's fucking weird, you know. It's very, very strange, man. It's the same with the Irish. The English want the Irish to win, but the other way around, the Irish don't want the English to win. And it's just, I don't know, I find it very strange. The banner's okay.
Everyone loves an underdog, I think, and it's hard to see the English as the underdog because of our past.
Yeah.
Maybe that's what it is.
Interestingly enough, I tried to get on Dave Cullen and Noel Plum too, because I wanted all of the accents, but I was only able to get you guys, so. I wanted to hear, what is it? Noel Plum is Welsh, and then Dave is Irish.
Noel Plum.
Is he?
No, he's from Northwest. I think he's from Lancashire, maybe. He sounds Scouse, but he's something sort of Northwest. Yeah.
I see. Okay, then I was wrong about that.
Is there a Welsh YouTuber? Does anybody know one?
No. No, if it's not Noel Plum,
I can't think of one.
So
you should get Dave Cullen. Have you had Dave Cullen on? He's got an accent.
Yeah, he does. Irish. Eagletarian says, can I get the Doge to say cummies? Well, you just did. I just wanted to read that. And someone else gave me, John Taylor gave us £5 and says Count Dankula for first minister and Buddha as his deputy.
So, a better job, that's for sure.
Guys, am I still low? Because I can raise my volume a little bit if I am. Oh, you know what?
I can hear you fine.
All right. I think I just changed it. All right. So anyway, there is a law against offensive speech in Scotland. And that sounds bizarre to me as an American. Now, we, at least right now, we still have, for the most part, absolute free speech. But it's definitely under attack here. But I am actually quite amazed that you guys have that, because look at how it's being abused. And this is just the stories that we know about. I mean, who knows what else is going on?
You know that saying, all bad things come from good intentions. And I think this is the case here. They had good intentions. They want to get rid of, you know, actual genuinely hateful racist people online, you know, who are doxing and harassing people, but they've stretched it too far, and now they're arresting people for jokes. You know, like there was one I was talking about the other night. There, a guy in Sunderland. I want to point this out because it's not just Scotland, right? There was a guy in Sunderland who was arrested last year. There was a bin lorry, which is a garbage truck, right? The guy was driving. I think he had a heart attack, and he crashed into the people on the pavement, and I think he killed six people. Just an accident, purely an accident. But this guy down in Sunderland tweeted and said, that was in Glasgow, so that's the most garbage that truck's picked up ever, you know? And it was clearly just a joke, but he got arrested for that. And I just think it's disgraceful that he can't even make a joke. So it's not just Scotland, it's Britain.
Wow.
I'm sorry, but the mean words aren't criminal. Like, I'm sorry, but that's not criminal behaviour.
Especially in Glasgow.
I mean, what would you hope the outcome would be from essentially wasting taxpayers' dollars, having police go away from real, you know, real crimes, real work, to go arrest people for stuff that's posted on Twitter? And by the way, you didn't even make that tweet, did you, Goodfella? That was someone else, right?
Well, I certainly don't remember making that tweet, so it could have been anybody.
So they don't know, like, what you're seeing, like, maybe nope. Your account was hacked or something, or
I auto-signs in on my computer, and I've always got Twitter open, and my house is always, it's like Grand Central Station in my house, you know? It could have been anybody, you know? I don't know. But the thing is, even if it was me, it shouldn't matter.
No, it shouldn't.
Because one, the word terrorist or terrorism was never used. And two, there was no call for anybody to be killed. None at all. And my argument is that I don't think that one person's context should be projected onto someone else. So if you, Brian, if you read that tweet, right, and you said, well, that obviously means, you know, terrorists and killing gays, that's fine if that's how you want to read it. Mm-hmm. But don't project that onto me. Don't become a mind reader and say that's what you meant, because you don't have the right to do that. You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
You can have your own context, but don't project it onto other people. That's not right. And people shouldn't be arrested for it. And that's one of my worries is, let's say this goes any further and I end up getting fined or imprisoned, right? How much power are they giving this one guy? Because he can go around and take tweets out of context and just decide, right, arrest that person. I don't think anyone should have that power.
I have to wonder how many Muslims in Scotland, and there are quite a few now, I wonder how many of them are arrested every time they communicate something offensive about gays or Jews.
Well, they can
the
take to the
must
street.
Be fucking swollen with mouthy Muslims. Or is it just
they can take to the
God's
street.
Man?
They can take to the street with a placard
I'm
that
actually
says,
working on a video. So.
Behead those that insult Islam and, you know, peace, go, freedom of speech go to hell and stuff like that. There's no arrests made.
Yeah.
I'm actually working on a video just now, but I'm not going to release it until after, you know, my festivities are over, right? But it's
everything's done.
I'm actually talking to people who are like in the SDL and connected to other such groups and everything. And I know that they themselves aren't actually racist groups, but you know, they do have a lot of racists in them, and they've actually been charged under hate crime laws. Like it seems that for some reason, quite a lot of them are. They were down at the corner shop and started, they were drunk and started calling the guy behind the counter a packy or something along those lines, right? And they got arrested for it. And every single one of them that I've spoke to have said that being charged under that law only made them hate the race even more.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Because they see preferential treatment. And it's just, they see every place that I'm looking in only shows that hate crime laws actually just encourage more divisiveness, segregation and hatred. They're completely counterproductive in absolutely every aspect. Like, there literally is nothing positive coming at all from these laws.
Almost as if that's the plan, because that's a bloody good point as well. Like, let's say, for example, I did make that tweet, and let's say I did hate gays. Is this going to make me hate them less when the director of Gay Pride presses charges against
me? Absolutely not. No.
Mental.
That's exactly right. It doesn't change attitudes. All it does is it basically silences you. And that usually just you know, makes you more believe more strongly in whatever it is you already believe in, because you're not talking to anybody and you're not allowed to. You can't even, because, you know, if whether or not something is offensive is completely subjective, then you can't even, like, say you were just critical, but you weren't hateful of whatever gay culture. Let's say you were, you know, I don't know, you just had like criticisms or something. Then you could come out and vocalize them, and then gay people could talk to you, and then maybe you'd have a conversation, kind of like, you know, that black guy that hung out with and spent a lot of time with the KKK.
I don't know if you know the story. It changed like 50 of them around or something like that, maybe even more.
But that was only possible because he was able to engage with them and talk to them and spend time with them, and then he changed their mind. And so if we had laws in, you know, in place that would not allow KKK members to put their views out there, to wear their fucking, you know, pillowcases, whatever, and just do their thing, then we wouldn't even know who the people were whose minds we needed to change, and they wouldn't change. Like, they would likely never encounter opposition. So
see the war on speech and the war on opinions is the exact same as like the war on drugs. The war on drugs fucking failed, right? Catastrophically, right? To the point where we now don't know who the dealers are or where the drugs are or who's addicted and who's not and all this type of stuff as well. See, if we ban certain opinions and make them illegal to talk about or voice in public, all that's going to do is make everyone hide these opinions, which means they're only going to talk to other like-minded people in the little echo chamber. And this is the point where dog whistling and stuff like that as well. So like, what will end up happening is all they've got to speak to is other like-minded people, and it means that, see, because their opinions aren't in the public, it means they're not subject to correction, they're not subject to debate. These people are eventually going to think that they're the persecuted bunch speaking from a point of valor and honor, and they're absolutely right, and the state, it's them versus the state. And see, when you have people in that little bubble for so long, that's when you get Dylan Roofs and stuff like that as well. They're going to end up doing something really drastic. And also as well, I want to know who these people are and what they think, because one of them could be fucking running for office, and like, you don't know what the fuck this person thinks, and you might even vote for them. Like, and as soon as they get into power, they might turn around and go, start loading up the fucking trains, boys. Like that just leaves us wide open. See, if you ban these opinions, these people, see how actual Nazis and everything, I see them as the enemy. But I want to be able to see my enemy, because an enemy that you can't see has the fucking advantage. And that fucking frightens me, if I'm being honest.
That's all true. Egalitarian gave us $5, American, and he says, Jeff Holliday looks like the lead singer of Korn. Okay. I'm just reading what he says. he'd probably make a really good jabroni, though. But anyway, okay. So we have these hate speech laws, and what's happened since then, Goodfellow? Are you just waiting at this point to hear back? Well, what's the next step?
I'm just waiting, and I got a letter from my lawyer. Just last week, and he said, well, let us know, give us a call if you hear anything else. So even they don't know what's happening, you know. I think it's simply that they know for a fact they can't prove it, right? They know that, right? But and I also know that the police are watching me, right? Because they know my Twitter, YouTube, and Facebook. They know, right? And I know they've seen that video, and I've put them on a very, very tight spot, because they can keep pushing this, and if they want to keep pushing it, I've got a little trick up my sleeve, and they already know what that is. I will go to the mosques and I will let the mosques know what the Glasgow police think of them. I will tell them, this is what the Glasgow police think of you if you happen to drive a truck. I'll get video of this, of their reaction to this, and I'll upload that to YouTube as well, so that everybody can see it, because I think the police thinking that a Muslim with a truck is a terrorist is absolutely despicable, and shouldn't, they should apologise. I really believe they should apologise for that. It's disgusting. But in regards to the tweet, I just wanted to point out that, and Justicar, I believe, Justicar's gay, Blair White's transsexual, right? They're on record of as saying that they hate gay pride parades. So the point I'm saying is, you can criticise and dislike gay pride parades without hating the LGBT community. It's not, it doesn't mean you don't like them. Because I don't like gay prides. I think they're stupid, but that's just me, you know. I think they're an absolute waste of time, absolutely stupid, idiotic behaviour. But that, again, that's just my personal opinion, which I thought I was entitled to.
We have a really big one here in Chicago every year, and most of the gays that live in the neighborhood where the Gay Pride Parade takes place hate the Gay Pride Parade because the traffic is terrible. You can't get anywhere. They just want to live a quiet gay life, whatever that is. but seriously though, they hate that, because the thing is, this is the thing about the Gay Pride Parade in Chicago. Nobody who lives in the gay neighborhoods goes to the Gay Pride Parade. All the people who go there are the college students that want to go and celebrate stuff that they actually don't participate in. Like, they're not gay. They're just there to virtue signal. Or they're coming out from the suburbs for the same reasons. Or they're treating it like some kind of, like the people who come in from the Chicago suburbs, they treat it like it's some kind of, how do I put it? Like a sideshow. Like, oh, let's go see the freaks, you know, and they go to the Gay Pride Parade to look. But they also do it to be supportive. Like, let's go support and gawk at the freaks. And then you have, you know, the really, like, over-the-top sort of, like, sexually deviant people that want to wear, you know, dress up in their bondage gear and all that. And they basically turn it into a spectacle. But the overwhelming majority of gay people who live in the city hate the Gay Pride Parade, hate it because it's such an inconvenience and it's so over the top and they can't get any rest and it's really noisy. And then there's a giant mess. They leave like a huge mess and, you know, there's condoms everywhere. It's disgusting. So, yeah.
Well, the way I see it is gays have been telling us for years, since the 80s, right? They've been telling us they just want to be treated normally, just like everybody else. Okay, fine. Don't dance in the street with tight leather shorts then, because that's not how you get treated normally. That's all I'm saying, you know?
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, if you're just... Because, again, when it comes to the gays that I know, and I worked in the entertainment industry here in the city and with the sort of like, you know, at playhouses and stuff, so a lot of gay people. But most of them are just, you know, they're gay, but they just want to live a normal life. Like, they have regular jobs and they wear regular clothes. They don't do the whole, you know, fucking village people thing. Like, that's different. It's a whole other animal. So
their sexuality isn't their identity.
Yeah, that's the fringe, but it becomes it gets pushed into, like, kind of like, you know, those videos that go around. I just saw a article. It was you've seen the video of the boy. It's like a little boy. He's got to be like 6 or 7, and he's twerking, and he's at a pride parade, and it was put out by Pink News, and I think they said, oh, you know, homophobes upset at little boy twerking in the street or something like that. And I'm like, what? if you're just annoyed with the fact that there's a 6-year-old engaging in sexually, like, sort of sexually suggestive behavior, that doesn't make you a homophobe. You know, that makes
they're going to invent the word pedophiliophobia. I'm calling it now. It's going to happen. You're a pedophilophobe.
Oh, it's pedophobia. I think that's the term that they use.
No, that's just fear of children. This is fear of people who fuck children.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Pedophilophobia. Pedophilophobia.
It's funny as well, because I imagine if you were gay and you shared that video of that boy, it would be fine. But if you were straight and you shared that video, you could be arrested for
it. Especially if you were a man. If you were a woman and you shared it, you probably would still be okay.
Ah, you'd be fine.
Yeah, you'd be fine. So, but what else? So Count, what's going on with your legal battle? Where are you at right now? What's the next step?
I don't want to jinx it again and say that, oh, I think it's going to end next time for like the 6th time in a fucking row. Right? But like, it's the 8th and 9th of November is when I'm back in. They booked 2 days because even the judge at this point is like, right, this is taking too fucking long. Right. So have we got 2 days booked in November? But some of the stuff that's happened has actually been pretty interesting. Like, one of the people that was in to actually give evidence against me was a officer from Scotland's Cybercrime Intelligence Division. You know, the people that are used to catch paedophiles and terrorists and, you know, human trafficking gangs and all that have been brought away from their very, very busy jobs to prosecute someone over a fucking meme. But like, one thing that was funny is the cybercrime intelligence guy was actually asked by the prosecutor to define for the court what a dank meme was. I'm not joking. I'm genuinely, and see the thing that made me, you're not allowed to speak when you're in the dock. You're not allowed to blurt out at all. But the thing that proper got under my skin was he got it wrong.
That's great. Hey, I'm gonna put this out to the chat. If you guys can give us a formal Webster worthy definition of dank meme, please put it in there. I want to see.
Meme is hard enough. Meme is hard enough to describe. But dank meme, that's even harder.
Yes. I'm looking forward to seeing your responses.
It's a piece of information that's repeated and is slightly soggy and.
That's funny. Oh shit. I had another. Oh yeah. So here's the thing too that I was just thinking about. Even if Goodfellas even if you don't get fined or whatever, and it's just a slap on the wrist after everything is said and done, that wasn't even like the guy who essentially made the complaint and he took the trouble to get in his car or whatever and go down to the police station and file the report. Isn't there a good chance that if this is made sort of public in the same way that Count Dankula's situation has, it will still have an impact culturally because people will become afraid to make jokes, right? Like, it's still a win in a way for them.
That was what I said in the video. I think that's the government's angle on this. They want to frighten the public so that they don't criticize the government, you know? And even if this is it finished for me and I don't hear anything else, this is still the law not working properly.
Mm-hmm.
You know, even if that's the end of it and I never hear anything else, I lost a weekend for this. The law is not working properly. And as I said, I even said to the police in the van when I was driving there, I said, we need a constitution in this country because my rights should be protected. See, if I was in America and the police came to my door and said, we want to speak to you about a social media post, I could have just said, First Amendment, fuck off. Do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
I'm protected. Go fuck yourself. I can't do that here. I don't have protection here. And it's so scary. It really is so fucking scary.
Yeah.
It's frightening that they can just take anything. And especially when you're like me, right? And if you've watched me before, you know that I make a lot of jokes. And you could easily take me out of context so many times with some of the jokes I tell, you know? So I could end up getting arrested again for some other joke or, you know, it's so easy to take people out of context. And I just think that's... context is the most important thing.
Absolutely.
Still, it could be worse. It could be Gregory Ellen Elliot, who got basically put on house arrest with no internet for 3 years. And not even for someone saying something on his account about possible terrorism, just for arguing with a massive cunt. That's Canada.
The lawyer said that to me that when he'll try to get me bail, that may be one of the bail conditions that I don't use the internet. And I was like, wait a minute, my son has to go without the internet, which he uses for homework and stuff, because of a fucking tweet. Are you serious? But even the lawyer, when the lawyer read it out, and the lawyer reminded me of Milo, by the way, he was very like, it looked like him and everything, sounded like him.
Wow.
And he read the tweet. For the first time, I seen him reading it, and he just laughed. He went, well, that doesn't offend me. And it's like, well, of course it doesn't, because it's not offensive. I mean, it's unbelievable, man.
They're pretending as though this meme can only be seen as offensive towards gays, and it completely taking it out of any other context, as though it has no basis in reality. But they acknowledge that it does because they only find it offensive because they think that it means you want to kill gay people with a truck.
But they do this though. This is a trick of the left, right? Recently, right? I don't want to get all political, but this is a trick of the left, right? Where they pretend they don't have a sense of humor.
Mm-hmm.
A great example of this, right, is when Trump posted that little gif of him playing golf and hitting Hillary with a golf ball. Now, you don't need to find that funny, right? But even if you don't find it funny, you know that it's just a joke. But that's not how the left ran with it. They ran with, oh, that promotes violence against women. And it obviously doesn't promote that at all. And yet that's what they ran with. That was their context. And this is something that the left have been doing a lot recently. They've been pretending they don't have a sense of humor when it suits them.
Besides, hold up
a bloody head of Donald Trump. Oh, that's hilarious.
Oh, yeah.
But if you swing a golf ball and hit Hillary Clinton with it, all of a sudden it's, well, that's just out of order. That's, you know, that's inappropriate, you know? And it's like, well, fucking make him. Have you got a sense of humor or not?
Have you actually looked at the hate crime legislation for the UK?
Is that the link you just sent? I'm looking at that picture.
That's actually a police seminar, and that actually relates. See how the actual legislation itself is so fucking vague that the opportunity to execute a huge double standard is massive? Because if you look at that one that I've just sent you there, it actually says at the very top, we do not need to prove hatred. Now, the thing is with hate crime laws is it doesn't even need to be violence. It doesn't even need to be words. It can be something like a sort of a physical cue. Like even if you just like narrow your eyes while looking at someone, all that matters is the supposed victim's perception of the crime. The supposed victim just has to turn around and go, I think he did X because I'm Y. Like that's all they have to do, and that's all the police need to run with. Because I've even seen it myself. Well, I worked as a bouncer for years in Glasgow, right? So I've seen a fuck ton of fights, right? And see, whenever it was like two white guys fighting, the police would come up and go, right, who threw the first punch? That's what they were interested in. They want to know who was the agitator. In this scenario, because they want to know who started the fight. But see, if it was ever a fight between a white person and a non-white person, the first words out of the police's mouth were, what was the white guy saying while he was fighting him, right? And I'm sitting there, I've even called them out in it, like, ah, why does that matter? And everyone as well, like, they were fighting. I was like, ah, it's in a moment of heat, in a moment of sheer rage and aggression. Basically, they wanted to know if the white guy was saying racist things. And in some occasions, yeah, they were. But in like probably about 90% of the occasions, the two guys were fighting just because they were drunk and being arseholes. One of them was being a dick and said the wrong thing or cut in front of him in the queue at the bar, and just a fight started. But the thing is, the police just totally abandoned like their usual protocol for when dealing with a fight, because they just wanted to slap the hate crime tag on there. Because there was even figures released saying, oh, so many hate crimes were actually prosecuted in Glasgow in 2016. And I just think, how many of them were real? How many of them were actual hate crimes motivated by actual hatred, and not just because you managed to find a roundabout way to slap that little tag on there?
What if you guys are beating the fucking snot out of each other? They already hate each other.
Yeah,
so they're both committing a fucking hate crime, whatever they're saying. And once you've started the fisticuffs, it's you might as well throw in a nigger or two, just because you're already fighting. You know,
the basis for the hate crime law as well is they say when they define hate crime, they say it's an actual attack on that person's identity. There's that beautiful word again. And they say that an attack on a person's actual identity, who they are, is much, much more damaging than any other kind of like verbal abuse. And I think any insult directed at you is an attack on who you are as a person. Like if I say you are an arsehole, that's still an attack on who you are. So it's just I don't know where the line actually gets drawn.
It sounds like it's very, just, it's very so subjective. Yeah. Zarynx gave us $5. He says, do you notice how this taking offense culture resembles the bourgeois attitude against gauche humor or gauche behavior? Also, Baring is in the chat. Hey, Baring, what's up? We have hey, Aussie. Baring. Is he still part? Do you guys like, you know, is Australia still kind of, are they all right with you guys? Or are they still like ex-cons and shit? Aye. Okay.
The only time Britain and Australia come to blows is over fucking cricket or some shit, man.
Anyway, also about the Hillary Clinton golf thing, did you just assume her gender when you said it was violence against women?
Oh, God, I know. It was awful. hang on. There's a knock at the door. That's the fucking police again. Shit.
Okay. Bullshit. They're fast.
Turn your mic sensitivity up so we can hear everything, man. If they come to the door, just say that you're a sovereign citizen and you do not consent. they'll leave you alone.
Exactly.
See when you're sitting in the cell, actually surrounded in the court, surrounded by literal criminals. Right, it's quite scary that they keep saying hate crime. You know, what you've been charged with, hate crime. It sounds really bad, you know, because as soon as I say hate crime, it sounds like, okay, this guy must have beaten up a black guy because he's black, or he's stabbed a gay guy because he's gay. You don't think that guy wrote a tweet. That's not what comes into your mind. But Punkster there is saying, good fella, tell them what they did to your young lad. I didn't mention it. I'll mention it quickly. The police take a number and say, who would you like us to contact? So I gave them my mother-in-law's phone number. She was looking after my son, but they didn't phone her. So my son came back to my house and I wasn't in, and they didn't know where I was, and they thought something had happened to me, until she went up to the police station twice to say, look, we can't get an answer. You know, they were going to kick the door in. But then eventually one of the police officers came around and goes, oh, no, we have him. We've got him at Shields Road or whatever it is. So my son came back home, didn't know, thought the worst, you know. So they put my son through that as well, which is what angered me the most, because I don't mind spending a weekend in jail. But the fact that they'd done that, they didn't do that, they couldn't even make a fucking phone call when I asked them twice to do so, that's what made me very angry. Because it's not like the movies, they don't give you a phone call. They make the phone call. You know, so I couldn't even make a phone call. And that was infuriating that they caused that worry to my son, you know. And it was very clear when I seen him on the Monday that he was worried, and that fucking annoyed me.
Yeah, and I understand that they took you in on a Friday so that they can keep you over the weekend.
Friday night, just after 7 o'clock at night, and then that was me in jail all weekend, and then I finally got out of court about 2:30, something like that, in the afternoon on a Monday, which, I mean, it's shit. I mean, being in jail, it really wasn't that bad. I was just alone with my thoughts, and I'm happy like that anyway, but it's just the fact that it was for a tweet. I kept thinking that to myself, I'm in here for a tweet, really? Really?
Mm-hmm.
It's just it's very, retarded. Very annoying.
What was your son? Who was your son with, though?
His gran.
Okay.
But that's what I mean. They came back here thinking I'm in this house. They hadn't heard anything, you know, and it's just that annoyed me the most. I think it's like pure incompetence on their part. They should have made that phone call.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they should have made that phone call to make sure that my son knew that I was okay, but they didn't. And he's left worried for the whole day on Sunday. He's left worried until the police finally say, oh, don't worry, we've got him. And that's the funny thing as well. When the police said, oh, we've got him, we arrested him, my mother-in-law, she didn't give a shit why I was arrested. She was just relieved that I was alive, you know, because she was thinking that I was in the house, maybe carbon monoxide or something like that, you know, something silly like that. She thought I was dead, to be quite honest. God knows what my son was thinking. But there was no need for them to go through that because of a fucking tweet. Do you know what I mean?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. That's ridiculous.
Absolutely.
Ridiculous. So Pallet Beer gave us $5 and says, when are we going to challenge the oppressive social norms about traps? Also, check out the Me Too tag. Catcalling equals rape. As far as traps go, Farron Meyer did a really excellent video that clarifies it completely. Just go ahead and watch that if you're really curious. Also, Pallet Beer gave us £2 and says, where's the food truck? # kebab lives matter, or kebabs matter. # IRN brew, Iron brew pride.
Iron brew.
Okay. And Baring is, I guess he's just now learning about this stuff because he's like, oh, I didn't know you went to jail or whatever. So yeah, Baring, this happened. If you want to, let me know. I'll send you a link and you can come into the chat if you want. And then we'll have another accent in here.
Feel free to do a video on it, Baring. Get more people to fucking notice this shit.
Yeah, this is
crazy. That's what my last video was about anyway. So if you want the full story, it's on my last video.
Also, I'd be curious about whether or not Australia has similar laws, because I understand, I think Dave Cullen said that Ireland is just as bad in terms of the potential for abuse of things like, you know, speech and stuff, like especially if you're using offensive speech. But I don't know if he had any, that's why I was trying to get him on, because I wanted to hear if this is something limited to Scotland. But go ahead.
But when you think of the Irish, I mean, these are like the manliest of men. It's real banter, and they're being, How can you have hate speech in Ireland when everybody's basically talking hate speech all the time? How can the police clamp down on this? It's ridiculous. It reminds me of the smoking ban. If they could do it in Ireland, you know, then they can do it anywhere. And the same with the free speech shit. If they can do that in Glasgow, they can pretty much do it anywhere.
Absolutely. It's very, I could see, you know, it's terrifying. Imagine, it could be worse. You could be in Germany. I mean, like, I'm sorry, but as I understand it, that place is like basically not free at all. I mean, the you know, as restrictive as it is, imagine if you had if Count Dankula had, you know, had his pug do a Sieg Heil in Germany, he'd probably be dead. I'm sorry, it's true. They take that shit overboard over there, you know?
But it's ironic as well, because I think Count Dankula has actually been offered a place to stay in Israel. Is that right?
Oh, yeah. I've had people actually saying that I could come live with him. I've even had Jewish people messaging me saying, like, I thought the joke was funny. I've even had Jewish people who've actually wrote to Ephraim Barowski, who is basically the chief guy of the Scottish Council of Jews, writing to him saying that they absolutely hate the victim narrative. The most Jews I've spoken to fucking hate the victim narrative. They really don't like looking like weak people that can't handle jokes, can't handle banter and stuff like that, and want to see people prosecuted. Because that's the way people think. People think that all Jews want people prosecuted for denying the Holocaust or making Jew jokes, and they fucking hate having that picture painted of them to the point where they were starting the hashtag not in my name. And everything as well. And it's just like, the fact is, like, see how they've actually wrote to him saying that you are actually causing the Jewish community damage. Like that, because it just paints pictures of them in a bad light. It's just it's counterproductive. I've said that. I've said it 100 times. It's completely counterproductive.
So, Baring, I sent you a link. So he asked for a link. So he should be coming in a second.
Do these people, all these victim groups, do you think they would be truly happy if they never got mentioned in a joke? Like, say the blacks and the gays and the Jews and all that. What if we just never joked about them? I bet you they would feel left out.
Well, we're already not. Annoy them. I mean, in many places, we're not really. I wouldn't say it's illegal, but it's not considered nice to joke about any groups except white people, white men specifically. Mm-hmm. And that's actually the reason why humor is so dead in the mainstream, because they can't tell jokes about anybody else. They can't even approach the subject. It's the reason why entertainment has just lost its edge. This is, I think, one of the reasons why everyone goes to YouTube for everything too, because mainstream just isn't funny.
America has its problems, but I'd be tempted to move there, you know, because they've got free speech, and that's, to me, that's more important than pretty much anything else.
Mm-hmm. I'm glad I got to experience California twice before it started flowing with rivers of AIDS blood, you know. So
Baring, welcome.
Eric, how are you going?
I'm all right. Baring.
So good fellow. What was this, a tweet that you sent or something?
No, it was a tweet that somebody sent from my account, and it said, "Where's a Muslim with a truck when you need one?" Hashtag Pride Glasgow or Pride Scotland, one the gay pride parade.
Someone hacked into your account or something?
That's my guess. Who knows? Who knows, mate? I just don't remember posting it, if you know what I'm saying.
It was Spartacus.
But the guy, the director of Gay Pride Scotland went to the police station and made a complaint about it, said it was hate speech, and the police arrested me for a hate crime of a sexual and religious nature.
How is it sexual?
Spent the weekend in jail.
That's unbelievable. I can't believe you spent the week. Like, maybe a fine or you know, a slap on the wrist. I can't believe they actually carted you to jail for the weekend. That's fucked.
Beyond a joke, man. Beyond a joke.
Do you guys?
That's my country now.
Yeah, that's Scotland now. So, I don't know. Do you think that could happen to you in Australia, Baring?
Well, I just sort of covered this recently. Something pretty fishy is going on in Australia, and that's that we're in the middle of a postal survey, postal vote thing for gay marriage, right? Mm-hmm. And they slipped through some legislation just a couple of weeks ago that's supposed to be about, you know, protecting vilification and all that during this postal vote process. And it actually it expands on our 18C law here, which is 18C of the Racial Vilification Act, and expands it to you know, gender identity and sexuality and all that, all the other sort of shit. And this the fucked up thing about this law is it says it outlaws offending people on the basis of race and now on the basis of sexuality, etc. But now it does have a sunset clause that it expires when the postal vote ends. But it provides a really good precedent to bring it back in when the Labor government gets voted in.
Wasn't this one of the things you were concerned about? Because you made a couple of videos about this law.
Absolutely. Because the Shadow Attorney General is a massive stickler for you know hate speech laws and all that. So it's very likely that the Labor government will win the next election. And so once that happens, this recent bill that they've passed gives him the precedent to pretty easily make these laws permanent. So we're fast on our way to having similar scope of hate speech laws. Yeah.
Oh shit, dude. That sounds fucked up. And here, who was it? I can't even remember his name. Cult of Dusty. He's like flipping his shit because you're not doing exactly like you're not just going along with it, and you have concerns. And I actually had concerns too because it's not. At least, you know, I don't know if this is additional information, but I know that when I looked at your videos on it, I said, yeah, you know what? I'm all for gay marriage. I don't care about that. But it's the stuff that comes with it that I'm worried about, you know?
Exactly, yeah. Cult of Dusty, I think, has a good heart, but the cunt's just retarded sometimes. He really is. Like, he just turns into a madman sometimes. As I said, I think he's a good person, but fucking hell, he's just... He puts the blinkers on.
Well, because you get so caught up in, you know, and I think this is easy for a lot of people to do. Like they want to see progress get made. And that the problem with, I think, with a lot of progressives is I think there's a good number of them that do actually have a good heart. I mean, the ones that tend to be less silent. That tend to be silent and they're not all crazy throwing trash cans and burning down businesses. But like the average person that considers himself progressive usually has a good heart. But the problem is that they're in a hurry. Like they don't want to wait. They want change right now. And what that creates is opportunities for administrators and people in political power that want other things to basically say, oh yeah, we'll get you that thing that you want that's going to give you equality and those warm, fuzzy feelings that you'll feel good about yourself. It's just going to come with some other stuff, you know, and the stuff that's abusable.
Yeah. Well, nothing about politics should be right now, unless you're talking about a war or something, you mm-hmm. know, politics should be discussed and debated.
Absolutely. That's exactly right. But most of the time people are they're in a big hurry, and that's true. You'll
end up with shit like this.
Exactly.
Like what Goodfella said before, I completely agree. I think Australia needs a Bill of Rights. You know, the fact that our countries don't have one is horrendous.
And it's been how long? Yeah, it's time.
Well, 280 years or something. I don't know. When did you kick us out, Goodfella?
I think, was it Mike that kicked you guys out?
280 years, you say. Hold my beer.
The Australians were kicked out because they were making Nazi jokes and we had to get rid of them.
Yeah, well, at least it's only a weekend in jail and not deportation, you know.
Jesus. Yeah, so I mean this is all worrying stuff, man. I'm sorry that happened, you good fella. It's really messed up. So what would you guys need to do to change things, I guess? I mean, would you lobby for well, you said that it looks like the Labour Party is going to win in Scotland. So you're kind of worried that more sort of this is only going to get worse.
That was me in Australia.
Oh, that was you. That was you. Yes, right. I don't know about Scotland. I'm getting my countries mixed up. Sorry. So in Australia, yeah, it looks like the Labour Party is going to win. So what about what about Scotland? How like where is the politics leaning?
Dominant party here is the SNP, and they're rampant SJWs.
Oh shit!
Like yeah, they are. Yeah, Nicola, feminist loving people, like to the point where Nicola Sturgeon, who is Scotland's first minister, and she's like Queen Feminist over here as well, actually follows Julie Bindle on Twitter. Julie Bindle was the woman that made the quotes joke that men should actually be put into camps because we're all dangerous rapists and shit like that. Like,
is First Minister Prime Minister? Is that the same?
Pretty much, aye.
It's sort of like, kinda.
So are they socialists?
Funny.
The Scottish Nationalist Party are also socialists.
Oh, she's even said that.
The Scottish National Socialist Party.
She has said herself that she wishes she could remove the nationalist from the Scottish Nationalist Party. I'm not even joking. She said that
herself. But that's dank.
does the opposition, like, is there anyone in Scottish politics opposing these hate speech laws? Like, is anyone speaking out against
them? People like Nigel Farage, but they just get called hateful, you know. So yeah, they're just branded as they don't want the free speech laws because they want to spread hate. That's how it's done, you know. So
they don't really have a presence in Scotland either. I think they have like one seat. I think.
No, people like him though. I mean, if somebody does come out and say, "Oh, these free speech laws are awful," they're just treated like Nigel Farage. They're just treated like these, you know, these are hateful people. You know, they want to spread hate. You know,
or just arrested.
Well, it's funny. You mentioned that Julie Bindle said that men should be put in camps. I don't remember her being arrested for that. Did I miss something?
Oh, they're just men.
Just white men. No one cares.
Yeah.
Having a fight with a white guy, as we mentioned earlier, and you call him a skinhead or a Nazi, or if you just generally call a white guy a skinhead just because he happens to not have hair, or a Nazi just because he happens to be white, like, is that a hate crime? No.
If we're gonna have hate crimes, it fucking should be. I mean, why is it that? It's generally, you know, if it's a white person, it's not a hate crime. That's fucking ridiculous.
Well, they're going to be busy at the end of the month because it's Halloween, and there's going to be lots of hate crimes in Halloween. People dressed up as red Indians and fucking God knows what, blackface. Jesus.
That's right. People are going to go as Indian chiefs and, like, you know, Al-Qaeda and shit.
I was going to go full meta and just dress up as the Remove Kebab guy from that Serbian music video, just from a little accordion and a Templar helmet, because I think it's just pissing in the ocean at this point. Now I'm in a job that I can't be fired from anyway, so I'm past the point of caring.
That's funny. I think I'll go as a crusader. Deus Vult.
Yeah.
That's definite hate speech.
Well, either that or a green frog. I think there's actually a, there might be a Pepe costume. I actually found, and this is as an aside, I swear to God, they sell this legit. They sell a costume on Amazon called The Wall. And it's basically just a shirt you put on with a brick wall and it says The Wall on it. And people lost their shit in the review section. It's just.
I wonder how many fucking ghosts they'll lock up as KK.
Yeah, exactly. I actually thought they didn't go far enough. I thought, you know, if I was gonna make a wall costume, I'd take it further. I'd put, you know, it should be made out of foam, so it's solid. Because the one they had is one of those kind of like, I don't know, it's sort of like that foamy cloth that you put on that's, you know, kind of cheap and shit. And then maybe you make it brick and you put like some barbed wire across the top and your head is sort of in the middle somewhere. And then maybe a couple of snipers, you know, on top.
And have a paper mache Mexican strapped to your back.
Yeah, exactly. Well, on one side is the Mexico side. So you have Mexicans trying to climb it and they're getting shot. And on the other side is the American side. And there's like venture capitalists, you know, smoking cigars. You know, stuff like that.
It could even be a couple's costume. Make it a couple's costume and get your girlfriend to dress up as a really sad Mexican.
Ironically, though, seriously, so somebody in the comments said just another brick in the wall. That's the funny thing, is the wall costume. There's no evidence that it's a wall costume about specifically the Trump wall. It actually looks like it's a reference to the Pink Floyd wall. Because of the way that it's written, The Wall.
They'll ban that soon.
They'll ban Dark Side of the Moon because it's got the word dark in it as well.
And moon, because that's a sexual reference, I guess.
Just like Fisty is a sexual reference.
Yes.
What a fucking dumb bitch.
It's like to you. Maybe to you it's a sexual reference, Christy, but I don't know what you're into.
Isn't it funny how she just took it there though? How she just took it as someone fisting a vagina. That's not what it fucking meant.
And she didn't mention what it was because she knew it doesn't sound like a sexual reference. Just maybe he calls me paedophile splinters or something.
Yeah, that was reaching a little bit. just a little bit. So
and Lena Dunham's nickname though, Sister Fister. I enjoy that, man. you must know about that. She actually admitted in her book that she like molested a little sister.
Oh yeah, with rocks. We call her Pebbles.
With rocks? What the fuck? What do you mean with rocks?
Yeah, she put Pebbles. She wrote in her book. She wrote a book about her life, I guess. And there was a chapter where she talked about the ways in which she touched her sister sexually while exploring her own sexuality. And in one of the chapters, I believe she said she put small pebbles in her little sister's vagina. And
I don't think she said that. She didn't say that explicitly, I think. Oh, just okay, one day her little sister had pebbles in her vagina.
Right.
And she... oh, my God. Don't you hate when that happens? You just accidentally get your driveway stuck in your vagina.
But yeah, so she wrote about that in her book. I guess I'm not gonna even attempt to paraphrase because I'm not gonna read her shit. I already spent money on Hillary Clinton's book. I'm not gonna spend more money on bullshit books. So, but yeah, so that's supposedly there were pebbles in her little sister's vagina, and her sister is pretty messed up too, actually.
But even if
has her sister ever said anything publicly about it?
You know what? There was some statement. I'm sorry, Goodfellow. I'll look it up while you make.
I think she called the backlash homophobic. She's a lesbian. I think she's off that bent, if you will.
I was just gonna say. Let's say it's true, right? That when you're younger, and your baby sister, who's still in nappies, diapers, right, shoves pebbles up her vag, right? Let's say all that's true, right? Why the fuck would you put that in your book?
Well, yeah,
would you tell anybody this?
I think that when you feel as though you cannot possibly, like, that can't look bad, then you're going to put it in your book, right? Like you assume that no one is going to think, that's fucked up. Like, you know, you just assume that people are just going to sympathize with you. I'm just a girl trying to figure out her vagina by playing with this other vagina, you know, like, well, whatever. And it's like this prepubescent vagina, by the way. I think when you're working under the assumption that you can't actually be lambasted in the media for it, that no one could possibly criticize you for doing that, then you're just more likely to just do it because people aren't going to make a big deal out of it. It's like, well, you know, why is it that there are some Black Lives Matter activists that can be openly racist against white people and just say the most fucked up shit in front of a camera? Well, it's because they've already been given license to do so because they're basically told that it's totally cool, you know? So yeah,
I wonder what sort of pebbles they were too. Like, you wouldn't have wanted to be like.
I hope they were the kind volcanic
fucking rock or something.
Hopefully, it's not fucking quartz, and it's more like the kind that you could skip rocks with. Yeah, I hope.
Gemstones, yeah. Nice smooth gems.
Opals.
like those stones that the hippie women sell and say, like these fancy stones, they'll do your vagina good.
They're probably mood rocks.
Well, you would be, wouldn't you?
Well, according to this, okay, so let me see. Lena Dunham's response, I'm trying to find it here. She responded to claims of sexual abuse with a rage spiral, calling the accusations disgusting. And then she writes in a tweet, the right-wing news story that I molested my little sister isn't just LOL, it's really fucking upsetting and disgusting. Even though...
How can it be funny and upsetting and disgusting? That doesn't make sense. That's their conflicting emotions.
Well, it's weird because this is an excerpt from her book, okay? This is the stuff she was criticized for. As she grew, this is Lena Dunham talking about her own sister. I took to bribing her for a time and affection. $1 in quarters if I could do her makeup like a motorcycle chick. 3 pieces of candy if I could kiss her on the lips for 5 seconds. Whatever she wanted to watch on TV, if she would just relax on me, which is in quotes. Basically, anything a sexual predator might do to woo a small suburban girl, I was trying. Maybe I thought she would be more willing to accept kisses if I wore the face mask my grandmother had for when she did her dialysis. What I really wanted beyond affection was to feel that she needed me, that she was helpless without her big sister leading her through the world. I took a perverse pleasure in delivering bad news to her. The death of her grandfather, a fire across the street, hoping that her fear would drive her into my arms and would make her trust me. This is from her book. Okay.
That's fucked up. That is fucked up.
She must be on a watch list. Surely she's on a watch list for that. That's ridiculous, man. I mean, it's psychotic, you know? And the thing is as well, she's a leftist darling, right? They fucking love her. Just imagine Donald Trump wrote that in his book.
Oh, my God.
They would go fucking insane. Insane. They'd fucking impeach him for it.
Yeah. Like, what happens if a woman accuses another woman of sexual assault and that other woman denies it? Which woman do you listen and believe to?
How does that look? Stuck in a vortex.
like neither of them. You just pretend it didn't happen, right? I wonder how often it happens.
Yeah, that's a fair question.
It's crazy, man. Pallet Beard is sending me stuff. I better read his stuff. I'm sorry, Pallet Beard. Five pounds. He says thanks. Pride Glasgow for making us faggots look like faggots. Brian, I don't know what he's talking about. Okay, Brian.
That makes perfect sense to me. Yeah. Perfect sense.
Tunnex Tea Cakes, Glenfiddich Tenets, you are now Scottish. Well, thank you. And then he also gave us $2 or 2 pounds more and says, read that super chat from earlier, you lazy dog. Well, I just did. So
hang on. If you don't read his super chats, will he just keep giving you money?
Well,
yeah, hold it.
He keeps trying to get our attention, but I am trying to keep up, but I also don't want to take
shut
away
it down
from
the volume. No,
don't. I also don't want to take away from what you guys are saying by reading the super chats all the time. So it's a delicate balance. Aiden Paladin is in the chat and she says RIP Scotland. Hi Aiden, how are you?
Good.
So yeah, I mean, well, I hope that something sort of, I mean, there's definitely got to be some changes. I don't know, though. It seems like I'm at a bit of a loss as to what you guys need freedom of speech, man. That's all I can say. Or you need to come to the U.S.
One of the things that I found quite bizarre, right, is see when the police said that they're going to detain me for a social media post, I said to the guy, Killer Part 2, right, and he didn't know who Count Dankula was, and I thought that was really strange. He's in Glasgow, he's a police officer, and he'd never heard of Count Dankula. And I just thought that was really strange, and I think that's one of the problems, is it's not getting enough attention. You know, because the police need to be ridiculed.
Right?
Yeah.
The police need to be ridiculed before any changes will be made. And
well, is it the police, though? It's the legislation, isn't it? Aren't the police just sort of doing
but I think if the police sense some mockery, they won't be so quick to knock on people's doors, because there must be a point where they can say, no, we're not dealing with that right now. Like when in my case, when that guy goes to the police and says, look at this tweet, surely the police can go, you know, there's a rapist on the loose, right? We've got other things to deal with here. Yeah. You're going to have to go away and come back at another time. But they didn't. They flapped around for this stupid law in order to arrest somebody.
The guy who organized is he like somebody important? You know, the guy who organized the Pride Parade, could it be that he was exercising some of his own pull to make sure that this happened? Because I think he just wanted to make a statement, right? He wanted to essentially make you into an example so that no one else jokes about this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So I wonder.
Well, I don't know. I think my personal belief is that he wants to get hate crimes against the LGBT community. So that because Pride Glasgow, who he works for or who he's a director for, it's a charity. It counts as an official charity, right? So I think he wants more hate crimes against the LGBT so that when it comes to more funding, he can go, look at the hate crimes against the LGBT.
Oh, yeah, that makes sense.
Not telling people that the hate crimes he's talking about are tweets that he's taken out of context. Mm-hmm. You know?
It's just—it's ridiculous, though, that they could say, "Hey, look at these hate." Like, this will be included in some stat that they'll use in, you know, to lobby some politician or something. That's fucking ridiculous. Tell me, what did they say when you said when you said that to the cops? Oh, I didn't make the tweet. Someone else has done it for my account.
Well, I didn't say anything. I just said no comment to every question they had. On the advice of my lawyer. So because my lawyer said to me before the interview started, he said, look, when it comes to a social media post, they cannot prove who made that post. So just say no comment all the way through the interview. So I didn't try to make a case to the police. I just said no comment to everything. So, and that's what my lawyer said. If you say no comment to everything, they will have to prove you made that post, and they can't do that. Mm-hmm. So
yeah.
Just say no comment. So I didn't try to argue with them because it's kind of pointless.
Yeah, but still fucking having to spend a weekend in jail for fucking for a tweet, that, especially a tweet that you didn't make,
it's impossible to know whether or not he made it. And it's irrelevant because it's like, exactly. You know, it's a tweet. Like, that's insane.
But
you know,
do you know what's funny about it as well? Twitter didn't delete it. It's still there.
So that's against Scottish, not Twitter's fucking.
Rose McGowan got suspended from Twitter for tweeting about Harvey Weinstein, but your tweet stays.
The Scottish police are more sensitive than Twitter, and Twitter's clamping down. So even they didn't remove the tweet, so it really
I meant to ask you, see how you said that you know it was the director of the Pride Parade who actually made the official criminal complaint to the police that got you arrested? Did the police tell you that?
Yes, they told me exactly who it was. They told me his name. I can't even remember his name, but
the police
told me his name, they told me his job. And they told me that they even told me the police station he went to make the complaint.
This is the thing is, I asked because I did the whole like I should have the right to face my accuser thing, and the police actually completely refused to tell me. I had to actually figure it out for myself.
That must be against the rules, man. Because they told me I didn't have to ask. They told me exactly who it was.
What I did was probably against the rules so that I could actually find out who it was. If I'm being honest, but I managed to find out who did it.
Oh, that's crazy. So if you guys, if you were to win your case, I don't know what winning would constitute winning. I guess not getting penalized or not getting fined or whatever. Is it possible to set some kind of legal precedent, perhaps? Do you think?
I don't know about that. I honestly don't know. I don't know the ins and outs of the law enough, which is why I listen to my lawyer, because I don't know what is going on there.
Well, speaking of precedent, what's happening with Dankula's case? Where's that?
He
mentioned that earlier.
He convenes next month. It's on the 8th and the 9th, and we think it's actually going to fully finish on the 9th. The only witnesses we've got to get through now is the two arresting officers, and then I finally get to take the stand, and I'm fucking looking forward to that.
You're going to take the pug?
No, we're not going to take the pug in with us. But my lawyer, like, I can say this because my lawyer said this out loud in court, so I know that the press know, is that before it gets to that stage, it's my lawyer's actually going to put in a no case to answer because it's complete fucking dog shit, obviously, the entire fucking case. But if the judge accepts that, and then that's it, just charges dropped and we can move on. But if... I'm actually hyped for it. I'm fucking hyped for taking the stand because I'm going to annihilate every argument that they've made.
Well, it's been long enough to wait to have your fucking say, isn't it?
I've had a lot of time to fucking practice. I can assure you, them dragging this out for so long is going to be the end of them because I've had a year and a half of reading into fucking as many freedom of speech books and the laws and legislation and fucking actual interviewing people who've been charged under hate crime laws to find out that they don't fucking work and all that at all, man. So yeah, they've kind of shot themselves in the foot by dragging it out for so long.
Davey asks, Dank, possibility of a countersuit?
No, I'm walking away from it. One thing I was told to watch out for by a lot of people is they say that, see how what happened with Tommy Robinson, when the police couldn't get him for the main thing they wanted to get him for, they looked into every single area of his life because he was causing problems. And everyone as well. So they found something. They even investigated his whole family where they found out like his cousin dodged tax like 11 years ago and shit like that, man. So like I'm worried that that would happen to me, that the police would proper come after me and all that. So basically I'm quite concerned about that because I do have a history. I'm not going to lie about that. You know, me getting arrested wasn't my first rodeo. Nothing like for this. I got arrested for a lot of dumb shit when I was younger.
You're a hardened criminal who's got a history of saying some other mean words.
No, I was like, I refer you to this MySpace post you made in 2008.
Fucking hell. Yes. Well, Shit. Let's see if there's any other comments in the chat. I think Aiden said something. Best of luck, Dankula, she says.
Thanks very much.
I mean, you'll definitely get to make your statement.
I definitely hope I do.
Yeah, and you're ready for that. So that hopefully will at least get people thinking. Your movie sucks too. Your moviesucks.org says, hey, boys, hey, your movie sucks. I met him at VidCon. What's up, man? What are you doing here? I guess he's like following what's going on. So, but this is, holy shit, man. Like, I'm still blown away by both of these cases. And I guess I take living in America for granted. This is what it looks like if you don't have that freedom. And
that's what I think.
What's social media? Like, what? So
that's what I think when I hear these stories in America, you know, about shootings and stuff like that, that I always think, but at least you've got the First and Second Amendment. At least you've got your right to free speech, you know, at least you've got that.
We can complain about it essentially for now, but there are people that are trying to take that shit away and, you know, definitely trying to expand definitions and fuck with shit so they can take away the First Amendment. But I don't know. I don't see that happening. They're really trying.
It's pretty ridiculous that the only two Scottish people I know are up on fucking hate speech charges for shit that happened on social media.
I know, that's the funniest thing. How is your dog doing, Dank, by the way? How's he dealing with this tragedy?
And to answer your next question, yes, he still hails. He does it without even asking now. See if he thinks he's going to get food. Like we've even had people in the house just like ordering takeaway, and if he sees someone with like a takeaway, he just walks up to them and immediately lifts his paw because he thinks food. Like it was easy to train him, but see, trying to like untrain him, man, like it's impossible.
Oh, that's crazy. And you did this as a gag for your girlfriend, right? At the time, wasn't that what the point?
I totally provided that. Yeah, I said the reason I was doing it in the video. I said exactly why I was doing it. I said it wasn't racist. The entire purpose of the joke was to turn the cutest thing in the world into the most horrible thing in the world. And even with that context in mind, that get completely ignored. And they're trying to say that I'm trying to normalize Nazism, even though what I was doing was making fun of Nazis. Because in order to find the joke funny, you need to already believe that Nazis are horrible people.
Yeah.
Like, that's the whole point.
Yeah. And the girl, are you guys still together?
Oh, yeah, but she was fucking pissed. She got fucking really angry when she first seen it. But then, Goodfellow will be able to tell you, see, during the arrest. Goodfellow, what is it like when a guy's getting arrested while his girlfriend's there? Have you ever, you've witnessed that, haven't you? The girlfriend
That didn't happen to me, no. But
like the girlfriend goes absolutely fucking apeshit.
It's a bit like when a guy's having a fight, right? And the girl just goes,
That's why I'm turning around to my here like, babe, calm the fuck down. You're not fucking helping. I'm just like, calm the fuck down, man.
Oh shit!
They just came in and fucking arrested me, and there was press outside my house and everything.
Fucking hell!
Yeah, that's.
I didn't have that. I mean, that's at least I didn't have that. The fucking media standing outside my door.
Oh, Jesus. They were outside the courthouse and everything as well, taking pictures. That's why. That's why. Seeing.
Who called them when they're getting arrested? How did they know?
I don't even know. One thing that fucking pissed me off, by the way, this annoyed me. I'm thankful that I've moved house. Because the prosecutor read out my full address in the courtroom, which was full of press. And read out my full address. So it's actually got to the point now where I still own the old place because I'm trying to sell it. But see how, like, on everything, like my bank and all that shit, I have not changed my address. And I refuse to until this is over because I do not want the press finding out where the fuck I live.
Mm-hmm. Do you get noticed? Does anybody notice you in the street?
Yeah, all the time. All the time.
Jesus. Mm-hmm.
I keep getting people like, guys, one of the things, like, see, whenever I'm out, like, walking the dog, It happened once when I was out walking Buddha, and these like a car that like, had about four guys in it were driving past, and they all leaned out the window and started like hailing and giving Nazi salutes and all that shit as they drove past me, and I was just like, "Yeah, thanks, guys."
Yeah, this
is worrying. It's worrying. It's worrying that you could, you know, you could just be out like walking your dog or something. All it takes is one drunk idiot to think, "Oh, there's that guy, fucking Nazi." Do you know what I mean? And in a way, the law have put your life in danger. Because there's more idiots out there.
I've had threats by Antifa.
Really?
And everything as well. And I've had stuff said to me as well by the Scottish Socialist Party. They're the same little scumbag group that did all that shit to Millennial Woes. They were the ones that managed to get into Scotland. They actually made Millennial Woes' address public, even though it wasn't his address. It was his dad's address, and basically placed his dad in danger and everything as well. I actually seen the reporter as well that did that. I bumped into him in Queen Street Station. He just glared the face off me, and I just laughed and walked away.
What about Peter? Anything from Peter?
Nothing at all from Peter, I'm afraid. I did get a lot of shit from those fucking vegans when I made that video of me eating a burger. vegans are the best bunch of people to fucking argue with, man. See if you want to have a great time. Make a video about vegans.
Oh yeah, Bearings had his exchanges with vegan gains that were pretty entertaining. Vegans are a trip, really. Yeah. I mean,
but it gets to a point where you just like, I don't give a fuck. We're talking about fucking food across that.
it just makes you hungry for a cheeseburger.
Look, I'll tell you that I'm only going to eat salad from now on. Are you happy? I'll only eat salad. Fuck off, cunt.
You're going to beat the shit out of me now. I'll tell you what, you go off and beat the shit out of someone, and I'll go off and eat a burger. And we'll...
I even fed some of the burger to the dog as well. I had a cheeseburger to myself, and then I started feeding a cheeseburger to Buddha. Oh, they tried to say that was animal cruelty. I gave my dog a few bites of a cheeseburger. I'm fucking
Satan. He totally didn't want it. Yeah, literally Hitler.
I watched the video. Buddha was having the fucking time of his life. Getting to eat a cheeseburger.
There's not much difference between a burger and dog food, is there? I mean, to a dog, anyway.
No, well, a burger's got less meat in it.
It's true.
It's got buns.
So there was I had one more thing, but I should probably close it out pretty soon, because once you get past like the hour and a half mark, people start to like, you know, lose interest. But fuck that, I did have one other thing I wanted to bring up, and I can't remember what it is now. It was about all of this shit. Well, I lost it. I can't remember. But I want to thank you guys for I can't remember. It's gone. But I do want to thank you guys. I wish you all the best on your legal battles and what's going to happen. Hopefully it's nothing serious. This is kind of a shocking revelation. There's actually quite a few legal things coming up. So, you know, Goodfellas waiting on whatever's going to come out of this. Do you have any idea how long it's going to be? Or are you just sort of like,
no,
they might not talk to you at all. And then it's just like over.
They may not talk to me at all, and then that'll be it. Over. And I don't know what the statute of limitations is on a fucking tweet. That's, you know, I don't know if it's the same as murder, you know. I'm not sure, but I mean, I'm thinking if the new year comes and I haven't heard anything, that's probably it, you know.
Well,
but
yeah.
I mean, if they take this further, they're showing how incompetent they are, because there's no mention of terrorism in the tweet, no mention of anyone being killed. They don't have a case. They also can't prove that who made the tweet. They can't prove who did that. Mm-hmm. They do know it came from my IP address, and they know that that could have been written on an iPad or a computer from this IP address, but they don't know who it was that posted it.
So tell me your babysitting fucking Dankula's dog.
he'll get it blamed for everything.
I remember.
But hopefully that's the end of it.
I remember now. Okay, so aside from appearing on other people's streams, like on YouTube and stuff with other YouTubers, have either of you guys been approached by the media for like a legit interview about what happened? Like essentially more exposure on this at all?
I was really hoping
tell them to fuck off. If that happens, tell them to immediately fuck off. Do not
I'll
talk
tell
to
you,
them.
I'll tell you who I want to talk to. I want to talk to Tucker Carlson. That's who I want to talk to. If he doesn't call, I'm not interested.
Well, you should let him know. Yeah, what
try
happened.
Get on Alex Jones.
If you guys
Alex
can...
Jones is the way to go, man.
Yeah, Alex
I'm
Jones.
I'm telling you.
Oh, I am him. Jones, or... Oh, I talked to him. I don't know.
Get him or Paul Joseph Watson to talk about it.
Stephen Crowder, maybe. Maybe Stephen yeah. Crowder. Let him know.
Well, yeah. You
I don't
could,
think...
You can probably get him through Dave Cullen. Dave Cullen has the means to reach Stephen Crowder, so you could do it that way. I think that they'd be very interested. But, Dankley, you were saying if they approach you, tell them to fuck off?
Yeah, don't take anything to do with the press at all. Mainstream
the
media. Main,
the mainstream media. Hi, the mainstream media.
Yeah, don't talk to them. Don't go near them. Because they totally fucked me over and made up complete fucking lies about me.
Oh, yeah? Completely. So what happened with you?
Oh, yeah, basically, there was a... I'll tell you the reporter's name, Xantha Lefham. I've tweeted at her, I've emailed her and everything. If you still want to actually come on a live stream and listen and, like, debate the lies you wrote about me, then that offer's still open. But she was saying stuff as well, like, I made a sort of a salty Facebook post, like, after this all kicked off when I was in Iceland, saying, oh, people keep coming up to me and asking for pictures. Really, really strange since the video offended every single person on the planet, according to the papers. Just a tweet like that. And then they actually wrote an article about me saying that I was now claiming to be a selfie celebrity and stuff like that, and thinking I was amazing and shit. And I was like, that's not what I fucking said at all and everything. And I even had, like, one guy calling me a yob and all that as well, which I actually got into quite a funny Twitter argument with him. I found him on Twitter, and I just started calling him a yob back.
What's a yob?
Which a yob is sort of like a thug. You're sort of seen as like hanging out on street corners, drinking, selling drugs. You
like,
know?
Oh, not like a bloke or a lad.
Yeah, sort of what a yob is kind of seen as and everything. And I started calling him a yob back. Every time he tried to speak to me, I just kept calling him a yob. And that made him really fucking angry.
But the real media, not the fake mainstream media, the real media should be on your side here. I mean, you'd think that they would be on your side and saying, no, come on, freedom of speech. You know, he should have the right to offend. But yet they're twisting it. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just scummy.
Yeah.
Scummy.
Well, that's what the media do now. Like, they need to make a story sound as fantastic as they possibly can in order to sell papers, you know, even if it means lying and who gives a fuck whose life we ruin in the process. That's the purpose of the mainstream media nowadays.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Well, let's try to make it happen. Let's try to get Goodfella on Tucker Carlson or something.
I can message PJW just now if you want, man.
Yeah, do it.
Yeah, I'll do it.
I'm going to show. No problems, aye.
Yeah, that'd be great. I want to see that.
To embarrass the Scottish police, then, you know, to get me views. I don't really care about that. I just want to embarrass the Scottish police. I think they deserve it. And the director of Gay Pride. I want to embarrass him as well, because they deserve it.
If either of you
do go to prison over this, we're going to organise a crowd to stand outside the House of Commons and organise an actual protest like we've never done before.
Absolutely.
Because this is something that's actually would be worth a real fucking protest with signs and shit in front of the House of Commons. Because if anyone goes to actual prison over this, it's the beginning of the end, man.
I already think it's went too far. The fact that the police showed up at the door, it's already went too far, in my view. The law is not working properly.
So after you tell PJW about what's happened, can you guys imagine his shock? Anyway, all right, well, we're going to get out of here now because I got to get going. So I want to thank Goodfella so much for taking the time to come on. No, thank you.
And thanks for having me on, man. Come on, anytime at all.
All right, cool. It was actually a pleasure meeting you in London, by the way. And we are, I think we're going back to London next year. Is that right, Mike? Is that when the
Birmingham. It's Birmingham, then it's the next one.
Birmingham.
Which is sort of halfway between London and Manchester. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I think we drove through there then. We must have, because we drove from London to Manchester at one point. But anyway.
Nottingham.
No? Oh, I see. Okay, yeah, I was right. We were in Nottingham. But anyway. So, yeah, maybe I'll get to see you. And maybe if Dankula's not in jail at the time and he wants to come hang out, we could also meet up next year when the Honey Badgers go up to London, which I believe, or not London, but to Birmingham, to the UK. I'm just sort of conflating shit. Fuck it. But yeah, thank you, Count Dankula, for coming on. Thank you, Mike, for hanging out with me. And thank you, Baring, for popping on at the last minute. to hang out with us. No, it was good to have you on. It was a conflagration of accents. Again, all I needed was a Welshman and Dave Cullen. We've been all set. I would have been really, really confused.
Imagine what the closed captions are going to look like. The auto subtitles.
By the way, Kevin Logan stays in Birmingham, doesn't he?
Yeah. Oh, I don't know. Done that. I don't think we're going to see him. Honest to God, if Kevin Logan showed up to the ICMI and wanted to hang out, I would hang out with him and I would get him a drink and be nice and cordial. I just don't expect
I think that he'd be welcome.
He'd
be welcome.
He is welcome. Yes, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So, yeah.
But, he won't come.
Yeah, he probably wouldn't. He'll probably make a video about it, though. Like, I can smell the hate in the air. I'm not going to do the Logan impression, but you know how it is. But, all right, so we're going to take off, guys. Thanks for coming on the Fireside Chat here on Honey Badger Radio, and we will talk to you guys.